95% voice.
Okay, oh really?
Okay, and who here is at a contact center where you have at least three channels? Let's assume, you know, any three channels. Okay, put your hand up. Okay, and what about, I'd say, five channels, and throw them out, like, you have voice, you have chat, you have email, you have SMS, you have social. Those are kind of like the hot five. Okay, and then who has what they would call a omni-channel contact center? They have it knocked down, they know what they're doing, they feel awesome. Okay, so let's talk about the myths and realities of a multi-channel versus omni-channel. First, let's start out with the easy thing, the happy land of the voice-only contact center, where you have your customers, they have just one channel, everything's awesome. They look at agent availability, are they available? Do they have the right skills? You have intelligent routing that's hopefully tied in with your CRM, and then the right case or the right conversation gets routed to the right agent. That's like the happy land. That's the past. We saw the slide with Nina showing that what everyone, how they want to communicate, how they expect to communicate. Now, on the path towards multi-channel, typically to make, and I'll keep on coming back towards efficiency and effectiveness. Efficiency in terms of, are your agents where they need to be? Did you plan correctly? Is there downtimes or not? Effectiveness, I'm thinking primarily, was the call resolved? Was the customer happy? So typically, in order for efficiency, what you do is you start introducing email tickets. You know, if you're not on the phone, then let's have you do something. Let's have you work on cases, or let's have you do the email channel. And there will be a select set of customers who, like, that's how they want to do things. They like to shoot the email off. That's getting less and less. This is where things get complex. This is the multi-channel environment where you have chat, you have mobile, and you have social. And this is a very busy environment. Now, the myth is that, well, in terms of customer happiness, we are responding to the customers. They may want to go on social, they may want to go on chat, or shoot an email to us. But the reality is that the experience is very, very much across those. I've seen it many times. I'm going to give you three examples where the chat was put out not by the contact center, but it was off the website and it was strictly a sales channel. Now, was the salesperson committed to that channel, like the contact center would commit to a voice channel? Many times not. They like the idea of creating a channel because, hey, that's just another form of revenue. But the problem is that they're not really adhere to it. So, they may leave their desk, go get lunch, and then someone comes in on the chat channel and it just sits idle. That reputation builds over time, and so that chat starts dying because it doesn't have that commitment level that you're going to see in the contact center. Social, this happens a lot, where marketing is like, we want to promote our awareness, we have to have a Facebook page, we have to have a Twitter handle, we got to manage these. But once again, they're not seeing it for what I think the social channel is, which is you have customers who get upset because they tried to come in through voice, they get bounced around on queues, they get dropped, they go on the social and they complain. So I'm estimating, based on my experience, like when I get pissed off and I can't get resolved, I go onto social and I complain loudly and at some point, I'll get answered, and I like that. It blows my mind when I don't get answered, because then I'm like, what's going on with this company? So if you come back towards efficiency and effectiveness, if they're not committed to the social channel, or they're not trained how to answer a typical response on a social channel, which is a complaint, which is owned by customer service, then all of a sudden, the effectiveness starts going down. Then you have the reality of planning for all this. So if these people are not a part of your contact center, how do you know how much activity they're getting there? Now, if you even pull this into the contact center so that the contact center is actually managing these channels, then you get into what I call the data dilemma, where at least with voice, your data is relatively as pure as it's going to get, so you can make your forecasting based on that. But if the data that is created by the social channels or the chat channels, like, is that even stored in the place that you can access? Because this is where you have the myth and reality. Create multiple channels, you create multiple data silos if the entrance point or the routing goes into different places. So multi-channel is great in theory for the customers, unless you have poor customer experiences, or that's actually what it's about, if the experience is poor. And then in terms of the efficiency and the planning, like if you go for the idea of the blended agent, that's a great idea. You're not busy on voice, so let's have you take some chats. But if you don't know where those chats are coming from, or when they arrive, then you're asking, why are agents not responding to the phone calls? Well, you know, maybe they put themselves into an agent state where they, you know, they're no longer available, so therefore they're available to take chats, or maybe they didn't, and they're just not answering the phones because they're chatting with people. It's really, really hard in a multi-channel environment where you have all these different data silos. So you have different routing points, you have different data silos, some of those data silos may not even be there, and then you want to try to aim for that uniform, that excellent customer service, because we are all competing on customer service and customer experience. But in a multi-channel environment, it's really, really crazy as you add more and more channels and you don't think of the bigger picture. So this is the idea of the concept of the omni-channel. And we're at a cusp where I think in 2 or 3 years, we're going to know everyone will be doing this and we'll be going and talking about conversation analytics and other ways to improve the customer experience. The idea of an omni-channel is that you have one pipe and all the channels get essentially digitized, so they all can pass through the pipe, which creates one data repository. And so you can have a mobile conversation, a social, a chat, and so you go through it, and you still check agent availability, agent skills, you know, for the blended agents. You know, can they handle voice calls, or you know, if you're going with BPOs or with contact centers abroad, where English isn't so good, so maybe, is my grammar even right with that? Their English is ain't good at all. So what happens is, you know, you can then use them in the routing so that they can only take, let's say, chat, which isn't so demanding. Or, you know, social is funny because it has a cultural context. So, you know, they may not be able to pick up on some of the nuances. But the nice thing is that you have that single pipe. It takes all the interactions, which are essentially digitized, pass through, and put in one big bucket filled with your data, and then from there you do your forecasting. It's conceptually so much easier. So here's a quick way to kind of differentiate between all of them. I have five key things to think about. But you know, the difference between multi-channel and omni-channel is essentially they're the same in that they have customers have multiple touch points. We didn't really get into this, but one of the problems of a multi-channel environment is the cross-channel. So in this particular case, like if you have a customer who went through voice, they got frustrated, it didn't work out, so then they tried to web chat, and it didn't work out, then they went over to social, and then when on social, they were told to call back in the contact center, come back in. And so you have these people who are calling cross channels, which are increasing the volume of calls, okay, which is wearing down into how much, you know, your average channel times, everything that the agents can dedicate to resolving this problem. And that's also another important factor. When you're in an omni-channel environment, it is so much easier to track first contact resolution and repeat callers because they're all ending up in the same data repository. It's so much easier. Okay, so omni-channel. So you have customers have multiple touch points, many across multiple routing engines or one routing engine and just access points. Omni-channel is one routing engine. It's one data mart. We'll talk a little bit about this, but every channel should have its own different kind of SLA because the channels have differences, nuances, and expectations of the customers. And then finally, where you're going is, you know, consistently serviced across all channels. You're not having that bumpiness, which is going to affect the customer experience. And also in terms of, you know, trying to get the ideal efficiency ratio that you want for your contact center. One last thing before I turn it back over to Nino is, and this is how to consider the different channels that you're working with, and actually Lisa at the end will talk a lot about this, which is great, is that you have different channels. They are, I think of three different axes that help understand the differences. The first one is, do your customers expect an immediate response, or can you defer it? You know, like when you come in on voice, you obviously expect an answer. I'd say the same thing with chat and social. Like when I go on a website and I chat with someone, I do it all the time just to see how fast the response times are. I'm kind of awful that way because I'm like, oh no, I was just checking. But is that, you know, you expect chat just to be almost as fast as voice. Same thing with social. I'm so impressed when I go onto a Facebook page or I use a Twitter handle and I get an immediate response. If it feels just like voice, that's awesome and you'll make people who are younger than me really happy. So you have immediate versus deferred, and then you have one-at-a-time versus concurrent. And this is where you really need a solution like Monet in terms of how do you build a proper schedule, because one-at-a-time you can only take voice calls. That's very easy to do scheduling for. chat. You can have, you know, 2, 3, 4 chat windows open. Theoretically, you can have more. I wouldn't recommend going above 4. I wouldn't really even recommend going above 3, because I don't like it when I'm chatting with someone and they disappear for a while. Because then, you know, and millennials have such a short attention span. And if I'm like hyper caffeinated, I have a short attention span. And so then all of a sudden, like, I've, you know, like, I'll start chatting with them, and then I'll be like, you know, pause, and I'll go off and do something, and I'll hear this funny dinging noise as the person's trying to reach back to me. And then I've just wasted that time, because I have to go back into the queue and restart the chat. So you want, you know, can you have, is this the response being as fast as possible? But come back to concurrent work. If you have too many chats open, you're going to mess with your response time. Same thing is theoretically, you can have multiple social posts, you know, multiple like Twitter handles running at the same time. And then this really gets into the routing, but some are continuous connections and some are interruptible connections, which is more of a kind of a wonky routing thing to get into. So that right there was a really fast way to start looking at some of the myths in